But you're doing some systolic processing on some food that I brought. It's actually from Turkey. It's Turkish delight. If you've never had it before. You should have one too. It's pretty good. It's from one of my favorite places there. That place has been around since 1864, in the same place. I guess they're doing well. Okay, we'll talk about virtual memory, and I'm hoping we'll finish it since you already exposed to virtual memory a lot. Who hasn't seen virtual memory before? No one, or you're too busy eating Turkish delight. One of those. Who knows everything about virtual memory? Who's so brave enough to raise their hand? That's tough, yeah. Okay, I'll put up this reminder again. Please start your labs early. That's important. I know some of you will be starting today, I guess. But hopefully finishing soon. And you know that an exam is coming up March 20th, right? Okay, a couple of things based on feedback that I received and based on the feedback that you've written, actually, which I'll summarize later on, but not today. We need to cover virtual memory today. Debugging, testing, and Piazza etiquette. You're supposed to debug your own code. Sorry for the bad news, but that's how it is. And you're supposed to develop your own test cases, too. Now, we do help you a little bit. I think the TAs have been very helpful in providing some test cases, right? But we're not going to provide you all. And this is real life, unfortunately. In the real life, you design your processor and you got to debug it. Nobody's going to debug it for you. In real life, you design your processor for some test cases and somebody else is going to test it with some other things. And if it doesn't work on those other things, we may have a problem. Right. So that's what happens in this course also. And the other thing that I received, Piazza, one of the complaints, one of the few complaints, which is good, in the feedback form was the Piazza answer times were not very fast. And I think some of the answers were not given to debugging questions, and I think rightly so, because Piazza is not a place to debug your code. People have developed debuggers for that. And if you're not here, if you're watching the video, hello. You can actually find a lot of the answers, but if you really need to, and basically don't expect answers to those kind of questions, but if you have a question about, for example, a concept, Piazza is a great place to ask that question. If you want to learn more about a concept, that's also another great place to ask a question. And TAs are not your debuggers, too. They're a valuable resource. If they were debugging code, this course wouldn't be running. But ask for help only if you do due diligence to debugging. So once you get an error, don't just post it to Piazza. Don't just go to Kevin or Rachada or any of my other TAs. Do your due diligence, and if you're still stuck for some reason, which is likely unlikely, then you can ask the TAs. Is that fair? Okay, everybody here agrees. And hopefully everybody on the watching the video will agree too. Okay? Having said that, late days. Who wants more late days? I guess everybody. Peer pressure. I'll give you a bonus. I'll give you 2 late days for everyone. You can use it on any lab. So hopefully this gives you more time to finish lab 4 and lab 5. Okay. Say it again. Oh, you already have 5. That's right, yes. You should know that. Well, if you haven't used it, I guess you don't need to know. Maybe you can cash in your late days later. Okay, but even if you run out of late days, please submit your lab. That matters. It shows that you're working and caring, and you're actually doing what's needed to do the course, not doing it for the grade. And who knows, that may lead to some other benefits later on. And making it work definitely counts. That'll help you in later labs, too. Okay, any questions? Now that I've covered the policy stuff, we can go into virtual memory, which is the real exciting stuff. Labs are exciting too, but we cannot do labs together here. Maybe one day we'll try. Collaborative, we'll call it collaborative labbing. in lecture. Collaborative online labbing. How about that? CALL, an acronym. Okay, we'll talk about virtualizing the memory hierarchy today, virtual memory, a concept you've seen before. So I'll try to go through it relatively quickly, but these are some readings. And you should probably look at your 213 textbook, which covers some of this too. And I've shown you this slide before. Basically, this is the programmer's view of memory. You do a store and a load, or load, stores and loads, and the memory somehow gives the data back. And we looked at some, we looked at the requirements of ideal memory. We want zero access time, infinite capacity, zero cost, and infinite bandwidth. And we've seen actually methods to achieve close to zero access time. Well, maybe at zero cost or close to zero cost. I don't know if that's true. And we've seen methods to actually support multiple access in parallel, right? High bandwidth. And we've seen kind of methods to actually make physical memory kind of appear large with hierarchies, or at least get good latency while having, I guess, reasonable capacity, less miss rate. But we haven't really covered the programmer's view of capacity at all. Everything we looked was really underneath how to do caching, how to actually improve latency while having reasonable reasonable miss rates. But let's take a look at the programmer's view. What does the programmer expect from memory? Basically, this is a slide that I've shown you before. Programmer sees virtual memory. Right? The programmer doesn't see physical memory today. As a result, they can assume the memory is infinite. But the reality is that physical memory size is much smaller than what the programmer assumes. Right? And the system somehow manages this virtual memory. It maps the virtual memory addresses to physical memory. And the system automatically manages physical memory space transparently to the programmer. And this has provided a lot of benefits. And we'll start with why this has happened. The big upside, as I've told you before, is programmer doesn't need to know the physical memory size or manage it. As a result, a small physical memory can appear huge to the programmer, and the life is easier for the programmer. And this is one of the most successful concepts that have made programmers' life really easy. And we've seen a lot of concepts. Out of order execution is another concept, for example. Programmer doesn't need to reorder instructions, but hardware automatically does it. You can think of virtual memory that way also. Programmer doesn't need to deal with space in this case, but the hardware and software together manages it. The downside, a similar trade-off to out-of-order execution, right? We can have more complex system software and architecture to support it. And that's always the programmer micro-architect trade-off. Now, in this lecture, we'll cover how we've come to do this trade-off and what we need to support, some issues in virtual memory. There are a lot of issues that, a lot more issues than we can cover in this lecture. Let's take a look at the benefits of automatic management of memory. First of all, programmer doesn't need to deal with physical addresses. And we'll get back to this a little bit. Basically, programmer doesn't need to kind of ensure that the program is in memory when it's executing and the data is in memory, right? Otherwise, the programmer needs to deal with that management, which is a bad thing. Hopefully, you never did that in your life. Did you? Did you ever try to move stuff from disk to memory? Unless maybe you were taking an operating system course and you wrote that part of the operating system, then you may have done it. But not in general purpose programs. And this, each process has its own mapping from virtual to physical addresses. So this is really going to be per process. Each process will see full virtual memory and will not need to deal with physical memory. So this enables several things, actually. First, in addition to this big advantage of making life easier for the programmer, it enables code and data to be located anywhere in physical memory. Right? It's very flexible now. So you can actually do relocation. You're not rigid in terms of the addresses. It enables the execution of multiple processes on the same physical memory. Basically, you can isolate and separate the code and data of different processes on the same physical memory. That's protection and isolation. It enables code and data sharing between multiple processes. Right? This is basically, if different processes are operating on the same data or executing same code, let's say shared libraries, they can actually share it because they can map the virtual page to the same physical page using different page tables. So let's take a look at a system with physical memory only. As I said, this didn't always used to be the case. Processors looked like this early PCs, most Cray machines, and a lot of embedded systems actually still look like this. They don't necessarily have virtual memory, although that's changing. Basically, whenever you generate a load store, you directly use that address as the physical address. The problem is this physical memory is of limited size because it needs to be of limited cost, right? What if you need more of physical memory? The key questions are, should the programmer be concerned about the size of code and data blocks fitting in physical memory? And if they don't fit, should they be managing it? And should the programmer ensure two processes do not use the same physical memory? How do you actually do that, right? If you actually just take the physical address and directly access the memory of that. It's not going to be easy, right? What if two different people write programs? Well, there's a problem. Also, if you look at from the other perspective, this was not the motivation for virtual memory, but an ISA can have an address space that's greater than the physical memory size. Today, that's the case. In the past, this was not necessarily the case. Basically, you can have a 64-bit address space with byte addressability, and you can have much smaller physical memory, because 2 to the 64 bytes is a huge number to have in physical memory. And what if you do not have enough physical memory? How do you actually map a physical address to an address to memory, right? You may not be able to have all the locations in the physical space. So there are several difficulties with direct physical addressing. One is this, we've talked about, this inconvenience and hard. It's harder when you have multiple processes. It's difficult to support code and data relocation, difficult to support multiple processes because you cannot protect and isolate between multiple processes. And you cannot share physical memory space. And it's difficult to support data and code sharing across processes. So the idea of virtual memory is to give the programmer the illusion of a large address space while having small physical memory. That was the main motivation. So that the programmer doesn't worry about managing physical memory. You assume infinite memory, and the hardware and software somehow cooperatively automatically manage the physical memory to provide the illusion. And the illusion, again, is per process. It's maintained for each process. And the basic mechanism, as you know, is indirection, right? You really have a layer of indirection that's sitting in between the address that's in the program and the address that's used to access physical memory. Actually, you can have multiple levels of indirection if you want, right? Basically, the address generated by each instruction is a virtual address. It's not the physical address used to address main memory. This is also called a linear address in x86. X86 has different names for things. An address translation mechanism maps this address to a physical address. That's the indirection mechanism. It's called a real address in x86, if you care. And this address translation mechanism can be implemented in hardware and software together, and we'll see how hardware and software cooperate to actually achieve this in a fast way. So this is basically the indirection part. Pictorially, you generate virtual addresses. An indirection table, called the page table, maps those virtual addresses to physical addresses in memory. And some, because physical memory is smaller than the virtual address space, some of the addresses, virtual addresses, may be on disk. Right? And in this case, it could be the software also, but we'll see that hardware will need to convert virtual addresses into physical addresses via an OS-managed lookup table. That's the page table. And this way, you see now, physical memory is really a cache for the disk, right? Or at least that's one of the functions of physical memory, one of the most important functions. You have all your persistent data on disk, but when you need to work on some pieces of data, you can actually bring it to physical memory and manage it through the physical memory. And if you run out of physical memory space, you basically swap out some pages back to the disk. Okay? So you've seen this before. Yes, this is all familiar. Okay, so I'll introduce some terminology that I would like to use. Virtual address space is divided into pages. Basically, hence the name page table over here. These are fixed size blocks. Think of it like the cache blocks, right? When caching, we're really dividing the memory space into blocks. Now we're going to divide into pages. Pages will be larger, but they don't have to be. And physical address space is divided into frames. Basically, virtual memory enables mapping of the pages to the frames. A virtual page is mapped to a physical frame if the page is currently in physical memory. Otherwise, it's mapped to a location in disk. And when you access a virtual page after you generate a virtual address, if it's not in memory but on disk, the virtual memory system automatically brings the page into a physical frame and adjusts the mapping. This is the idea of demand paging. That's used in all the systems that you use today. And the page table is a table that stores the mapping of the virtual pages to physical frames. That's the indirection table. That's the translation table. Right? Okay. So physical memory, in other words, is a cache, right? It's a cache for the pages stored on disk. In fact, it's really a fully associative cache in modern systems. And we will see this. A virtual page can be mapped to any physical frame. There are no restrictions, right? Okay? And similar caching issues, as we covered in the past few lectures, exist in this case also, right? Where and how to place or find a page in the cache or in the physical memory, right? What page to remove to make room in the cache? Replacement. Same issue exists. And we'll see that. We'll see some algorithms. Just one, actually. Granularity of management. Do you have large cache blocks, small cache blocks, uniform size cache blocks? Large pages, small pages, uniform size pages. Write policy. What do we do about writes? Do we have a write-back cache? Do we have a write-through cache? Is your physical memory write-back or write-through? Well, write-back may make sense if the disk is so far away, right? Okay? So let's take a look at supporting virtual memory at the high level very quickly. This requires both hardware and software support, and hopefully it'll become clear, because if every time, whenever you need to access a location, you need to do this translation, and you need to access this huge table, and that table is in software, is in memory, then you have a problem, right? Which means that for every access to memory, you're doing another access to memory to do the translation. Well, we'll speed this up. Basically, page tables in memory, and it can be cached in special hardware structures called translation look-aside buffers that accelerate the translation process. And translation look-aside buffer is also a cache, by the way. It's really caching portions of the page table that you have recently used. That's why caching is so important. Now we're adding more and more caching everywhere to solve access latency problems. And the hardware component is, in general, the overall hardware component is called the MMU, the memory management unit. This includes the TLBs, page table base registers that you need to have to access the page table, and page walkers, which we will talk about. It is the job of the software to leverage these hardware structures to populate the page tables and decide what to replace in physical memory when you need to do a replacement, and change the page table base register on a context switch. So because remember, this is, again, page tables per process, which means that whenever you change the process, you'd better access the right page table when you're doing the translation, which means that you need to have a page table base register as part of your context for each process. And the system software also needs to handle page faults and ensure correct mapping once a page fault is handled. Okay. There are actually other tasks for the system software. System software spends a lot of its time managing this translation. It needs to keep track of which physical pages are free, for example, because you may not be using the entire physical memory, right? Some physical frames may be empty. And when you need to allocate a new physical page, I should probably say physical frames, okay. I want to fix it right now so that I don't forget it later, if PowerPoint allows me to do this. I like using the term physical frames to not confuse it with pages, because physical page and virtual page kind of gets confusing. It's really a frame. It's really a place in memory that's kind of, you can touch that, right? Whereas a virtual page, you cannot touch it because it's really virtual. It may or may not be there. Basically, the system software is responsible for allocating free physical frames to virtual pages also, after consulting this table. It's also responsible for replacing pages. When there's no physical frame is free to allocate to a page that you want that's coming from disk, what should be swapped out? What frame should you kick out? It also helps sharing pages between processes. Again, you have a shared library, let's say. You really want to share that code of a library between between different processes. And also maybe you may have shared data structures that are being operated by different threads. It also does other optimizations, which we will not necessarily get into, but I'd like to tell you so that you at least have an idea. Copy on write, for example. Let's say you're actually forking a process, and you need to copy all of the pages, because when you fork a process, you copy the entire memory space to the memory space of the new process. Right? Do you do all of that copying right away, or do you do that copying whenever the new process that you fork needs to write to that? Right. One thing the system software can do is you fork the process right away, and what you do is you map the virtual pages of the new process to the physical frames of the process that you forked from, because they're sharing the memory. Now they will share the pages or frames in physical memory. And when this new process or when the old process writes to that particular page, at that point you copy the page. You allocate a new frame for the separate page. But to be able to do this, you need to keep track of the fact that this page is actually shared between two different processes, right? That's the idea of copy on write. What this saves is, if you're never going to write to memory in either of the processes, you never copy anything. You just share the pages that already exist and ensure that the mapping works. And if you were doing very few writes, again, you win, right? You never copy unnecessarily. Page flip optimization is another case here. This is actually, I'm not going to go through this in detail, but this is related to changing permissions, for example. When you get some data with a process, if you want to actually give it to another process, maybe you want to flip the permissions, right? And you can do this by flipping the address mappings. So if you're interested, you can search for it, but we're not going to cover these in detail. But remember that system software is actually responsible for doing these, and making these optimizations are enabled by this indirection mechanism. If you don't have this indirection mechanism, you cannot do copy on write, because you cannot even share pages, right? Okay. So page faults, you've seen this before too. You can think of this as a miss in physical memory, right? Basically, if a page is not in physical memory but disk, the page table entry indicates virtual page is not in memory. Basically, it doesn't have a corresponding physical frame. And access to such a page triggers a page fault exception. At that point, the OS exception handler or trap handler is invoked to move data from disk into memory. In the meantime, other processes hopefully can continue executing. And OS has full control over the placement of the new frame, like where should this new page that's coming in should be mapped. So if you look at this, when the CPU accesses this page that is not mapped, that's mapped to the disk, but that's not mapped to the physical memory, after fault, it will be mapped to physical memory. And there needs to be mechanisms to handle this. And this this takes time, obviously. So why does it take time? Basically, what does it take to service a page fault? When you get a page fault, the processor needs to signal the I/O controller, the disk controller, to get the page in the disk. And how do you figure out where it's in the disk? Well, the page table actually stores that information. Right? The page table says, I don't have it in physical memory, but here is the address in the disk. And you get that. And you do the read. And this read doesn't need to be done by the processor. It can be done by the I/O controller. And you can actually do direct memory access. So you can actually have a controller that directly transfers data from the disk to the memory without involving the processor. In fact, it makes no sense to involve the processor, right? Because the data is really going from the disk to memory. And once this transfer is done, once the page is transferred from the disk to memory, you interrupt the processor, and the OS can now resume the suspended process. That's the end of the page fault handling. Okay? At least that's how it's done today. If you have a data flow system, you don't interrupt the processor, right? You just signal the availability of data. Okay, so page tables per process, I've shown you this before. I'll go through this very quickly. Each process has its own virtual address space for process one, for process two. And they need to have their own page table base registers to distinguish these two different page tables. Basically, each process has the full address space. The simplified memory allocation, sharing, if you look over here, two different virtual pages in these different processes are mapped to the same physical page. could be library code, for example. Okay, it also eases a lot of other things that you can, that you have probably seen in 2013. So one big aspect of virtual memory is address translation, doing this indirection. Let's take a look at how it is done. How do you obtain the physical address from a given virtual address? So page size is specified by the ISA. Right? We've seen it, and you've seen it before. In the old times, page sizes were relatively small. They increased, and they keep on increasing, actually. VAX, for example, remember the VAX? We talk about the complicated VAX ISA. It had 512 byte pages. Today, we have pages that are of 4 kilobytes, 8 kilobytes, and we also have large pages. So you actually have different size pages in modern ISAs. x86, we will see examples from x86 with 4 kilobyte and 4 megabyte pages, for example. And we'll get to the trade-offs of page size. It's kind of a similar trade-off as the cache lectures in a different domain, right? Do you have small cache blocks or large cache blocks? Well, remember, one problem with the small cache blocks was the size of the tag store. Well, in this case, your tag store is your page table. If you have small pages, the size of your tag store, page table, needs to be large also, because you need to keep track of more of these blocks or pages. So similar trade-offs exist here. And the page table contains an entry for each virtual page. This is called a page table entry, PTE. And what's in a PTE we will look at. Now, this is kind of the cartoonish picture that I had for translation. You have this virtual address that the processor generates. And we would like to get a physical address. This part over here, which byte in a page, remember, you have a page and you have a physical frame. The size of the physical frame is the same as the size of the virtual page. As a result, there are some bits in the address that do not change during the translation. You don't need to translate them because they're really part, it's kind of the offset within the page, which is the offset within the frame. So this part doesn't change, but you need to translate the number, page number, virtual page number, to a physical frame number. Which location in physical memory is this page? And that's the job of the translation engine. And this is one example. You'll need to do this example many times, probably. And you've probably done it before. So if you have an 8 kilobyte page size and a 32-bit virtual address space, your virtual page number needs to be 19 bits, right? It's basically 32 bits? Yeah, 32 bits. Basically, you have 13 bits to specify the offset over here, assuming this is byte addressable, again. As a result, the tag or virtual page number needs to be 19 bits. Now you see the similarities with caches, hopefully. So you have 2 to the 19 virtual pages in this case, which means that you need to have 2 to the 19 page table entries in the page table for each process. Now you can imagine how big this can get, right? If you have 1,000 processes, that's a lot of entries to keep. Where do you keep this? And we'll get to this. And this is a more generalized example of this. And you can go through this, basically. Page offset bits don't change as a result of the translation. But these bits will change. So let's take a look at another example. So how is this done per process? Basically, you have a separate set of page tables per process. Virtual page number forms an index into the page table. Basically, what you do is, I'm going through this relatively fast because the assumption is you've already seen this in 2013. If you haven't, shout. Nobody's shouting, so I'm assuming it's done. Basically, you have a page table base register per process. You take that, and you add to it the virtual page number to get to the location that specifies, to get the address of the location that has the page table entry for that virtual page number. Okay? And the page table entry provides information about the page. So it has a valid bit. It's set if the page is in physical memory. If it's not valid, the page is not in memory. It can have other bits, as we will see. It can have access bit, for example. Remember, this is really a cache, again. You may want to have access bits to decide what to replace, for example. You may want to have a dirty bit if it's write back. And physical memory is almost always write back. And the physical frame number. And this is the translation that you have. So if it's valid, then this physical address is also valid. then you do the translation. If it's not valid, then you basically need to handle the page fault. Okay. So this is a page shit case, basically what I described. You get the virtual address, access the MMU. MMU provides you the page table entry address. Based on that page table entry address, you access memory and get the page table entry, and then do the translation, and then get the physical address, access memory again to get the data. So that's the indirection, right? You need to access physical memory twice. First to get the page table entry, second to get the real address that you're looking for in case of a page hit. Make sense? So of course, we're going to eliminate this access by adding a TLB over here. If you get a page fault, it becomes more complicated. Basically, you get the page table entry address, you get the page table entry, and you figure out that there's an exception because the page table entry says this virtual page is not valid. It's not in physical memory. You generate an exception. You go into the page fault exception handler, and page fault exception handler needs to first evict a page in physical memory, assuming it's full. The free list is empty, free page list is empty. It evicts that page and then brings a new page from the disk, and then you can do the translation and access the physical memory again. Okay. So what's in a page table entry? Well, again, page table is really a tag store for the physical memory data store, right? It gives you a mapping table. It's a mapping table between virtual memory and physical memory. Just like the tag store is a mapping table between the address and the data store of the cache, right? So page table entry is the tag store entry for a virtual page in memory. So you need a valid bit to indicate validity or presence in physical memory in the data store. You need tag bits, which is the physical frame number, to support the translation. You need bits to support replacement. Remember, I said that physical memory data store is really a fully associative cache, right, in a sense. So you need bits to figure out if that data store is full, what to replace. And you need a dirty bit to support write-back caching. You could make the choice that physical memory is write through, but that may not be a good idea. Whenever you do a write, does the write go all the way to disk? Again, the same issue exists as we've discussed in caching. And in addition, this is different from caching, you actually need protection bits to enable access control and protection. So we're going to tack on another functionality to virtual memory, which is actually to support protection. And we'll cover this in a little bit. So this is my cartoonish picture of what the page table entry looks like. Basically, this is the valid bit. This is the physical frame number. If this is valid, then physical frame number indicates which physical frame this virtual page is mapped to. We have a dirty bit. We have some reference or access bits. This can be multiple bits, but we'll discuss the use of the R bit. That's kind of, you can have one bit saying this was recently referenced. And the protection bits. Basically, can this process access this page? What kind of access can it perform on this page? And you can have other things also. And we'll look at some, very, very quickly look at some page table entries in x86. Okay. Again, remember, this is a slide that I showed you earlier. Physical memory is a cache for disk, except it's managed by the system software via the virtual memory subsystem. And page replacement is actually similar to cache replacement. And I already said this. What is the difference? You should probably remember this slide now, because it was in the last lecture, or maybe the previous lecture. Basically, required speed of access to cache versus physical memory. When you need to replace a page in physical memory, then actually you have a lot of time, right? Because you are now in the system software because you're going to bring something new in, and it will take a lot of time. Whereas in the cache, you don't have a whole lot of time. You really need to bring something from memory, which is relatively quick compared to the disk. And there are in terms of the number of blocks in the cache versus physical memory is huge, right? If you have 16 gigabyte physical memory, you have lots of blocks or lots of pages. Whereas in a cache, you usually don't have that many blocks. So searching for the best replacement candidate may be a little bit more difficult than physical memory because you have so many blocks. And we already discussed this. And what is the role of system software versus hardware? Since a hardware cache is managed purely by hardware, system software doesn't get involved in it, right? although as an architect, you should always think, should I involve software in caching decisions? If you have a huge hardware cache, maybe you should involve the system software or software in those decisions, because you can make a better decision potentially, right? But in processor caches today, software doesn't get involved, right? Whereas the physical memory, it's a cache for disk, and the software is very heavily involved in that. In fact, software is doing the replacement, right? System software. So let's very quickly take a look at page replacement algorithms. If physical memory is full, or in other words, list of physical free physical pages is empty, what physical frame do you replace on a page fault? That's the key question here, right? This is a good exam question, probably. Is true LRU feasible in this case? I'll give you the same question that I asked earlier. Let's say you have 4 gigabyte memory, 4 kilobyte pages. How many possibilities of ordering do you have? You can probably express this as a form, as a closed form equation in an exam, right? It's basically, what is it? This divided by this factorial, right? And that's a huge number. Even encoding that is a huge number. It's log 2 to the 4 gigabyte divided by 4 kilobytes factorial. That's the encoding. So that's a lot. So modern system, as a result, use approximations of LRU. Now they're doing better right now. But when initial systems that use demand paging use something called the clock algorithm. Do you guys know this? You haven't studied this in 2013? Really? You didn't study page replacement at all in 2013? No, not really? Well, you're TAing it. You probably know. Okay, well, I guess you'll learn the clock algorithm in this class. But there are more sophisticated algorithms that are used today, actually, in operating systems to incorporate frequency of use. Right? Operating systems don't just look at recency of use, but they actually try to keep in physical memory frequently used pages, too. I'm not going to talk about these, but one example is the ARC algorithm. I believe it's called Adaptive Replacement Cache, a self-tuning low-overhead replacement cache. It was published in this conference. It's kind of one of the cute algorithms. Basically, you divide the physical memory into two pools. And one pool, you monitor the accesses that are happening. And if you see a lot of accesses, you say, oh, these pages are receiving a lot of access, so I'm not going to replace them as easily. I'm going to move them to another pool. So I said, I'm not going to disturb the replacement algorithm. Usually, I'll try to replace from this pool. So if I don't use physical pages quickly, they'll stay here, and they will need to be replaced from there. Anyway, if you want to learn more about it, you can take a look here. But there have been many algorithms that were developed. One of the simplest ones is the clock algorithm. Basically, this is another approximation to LRU. Remember, we saw approximations to LRU in the hardware caches. This is a system software side approximation to LRU. It's not exactly LRU because the ordering is really hard to maintain if you have so many pages. But the idea over here is you keep a circular list of physical frames in memory that kind of looks like this. And these are actually the reference bits. And keep a pointer or hand to the last examined frame in the list. And we'll figure out what that last examined frame is. When a page is accessed, when you access a page, you set the R bit, reference bit in the PTE, page table entry. And when you need to replace a frame, when you're full, when you're accessing a page that doesn't exist in memory, what you do is you take this hand and you basically go clockwise, that's why it's called a clock. Look, it operates like a clock. You clockwise, and you try to find the frame that has the reference bit not set. So here, if your hand is pointing to this frame with the reference bit not set, then you replace this one. Otherwise, you go to the next one. You try to find one that has the reference bit not set. Make sense? And what you're really trying to do is not to replace a page that was recently referenced. So this is kind of an not MRU-like approximation, actually. You don't want to replace one of the most recently used pages. Okay? And basically, the clock keeps going and going. Then the key question is, what do you clear? When do you clear these R bits, reference bits, or access? It's also called the access bit. Well, during traversal, while you're traversing it, you clear the R bits of the examined frames. If the R bit is set, you're not going to replace it, but you're going to clear the bit. And then you move on to the next one. until you find one that has an arbit not set. It's pretty simple, right? Well, why does it make sense to clear? Well, you probably recently accessed it. Well, when do you set it, first of all? Basically, well, I guess I said when you set it, actually. When a page is accessed, you set the arbit. And when you're examining it, you clear it, because you'll revisit it only after you've visited every other frame in the system. Right? So hopefully, that'll be a long time later. Okay? You can imagine more algorithms, and people have developed other algorithms, like a second chance algorithm. Basically tries to give the frames a second chance, or pages a second chance to stay in memory. So you don't need, you don't have one bit, but maybe you give it a second chance. Okay, and then of course, after you do this, you set the hand pointer to the next frame in the list. And then that's where you will start the next replacement, when you need to replace something. Is this clear? This is a very simple algorithm, and you can imagine cases where this is not a good idea, right? This may not work very well. It's really an approximation to least recently used. It doesn't take into account frequency, as you see. There's nothing about how frequently a page is accessed here. But you can increase the size of the counters, maybe. If the counter is, like, whenever you access a page, you increment the counter, then now you're taking into account frequency a little bit. Now you know clock. You can answer interview questions easily. Yes?
So is the arbit in the page table?
Yes, arbit in the page table. It's part of the page table entry.
So when you do this page replacement algorithm, do you only traverse the page table for that process that you're trying to find a new page for?
No, actually, this is very interesting. That you're actually asking a really good question. This is really the frames in physical memory, right? Because you can deallocate a frame. So what the operating system does is it doesn't have to do it per process. So you really need to figure out which frame to replace in the end. So traversing the entire page table may not be a bad idea, because that's huge, whereas the physical memory space is smaller. So you really need to go through the frames. So how do you do that? And actually leads to some concept that's used in some systems today. Well, you have the frame. You really have the physical addresses, and the frames are ordered. Well, frames are kind of in a circular order. You want to get the page table entry for that frame, really. It's kind of the reverse problem, right? You know the physical address, but you want to get the page table entry. Whereas page table was accessed, you get the virtual address, and you want to get the page table entry. You can do that easily, right? Because the page table is really designed for taking the page table base register, adding the virtual page number, and you get the page table entry. But now you want to figure out, you kind of have the addresses of the frames because you know the physical memory. How do you get the page table entry? Have you ever heard of inverted page tables? Well, this is one reason to have an inverted page table, basically. You have the reverse mapping. Physical memory is mapped to, you have a reverse mapping for each physical frame in memory, you have a mapping to the page table entries. Okay? That's the idea of an inverted page table. And if you have an inverted page table, you can do this really, really easily. Right? Okay? You can imagine doing it in other ways also, but an inverted page table helps a lot. Okay. I'm not planning to introduce it, but now I've introduced it. Now we can ask questions about it, right? Actually, that could have been a really good question on an exam. Giving you the inverted page table and asking you why you need it. So once you know how the system works, these questions are really easy, actually. You can come up with it, too. Okay. Let's take a look at some other trade-offs. I call this an aside, but I'll quickly go over it also, because it's kind of similar to the trade-offs that we've seen in caches. What should be your page size? Well, what is the granularity of management of physical memory? Similar question we asked. What is the granularity of management of your cache, right, data store? Do you have large or small pages? And there are many different trade-offs with advantages and disadvantages here. I'll not go through these quickly. I'll not go through these in detail. Did you see this in 213, by the way? Benefit of large pages versus small pages? No? Okay. I guess you can imagine the cache. Size of the page table, right? Tag store. If you have small pages, your page table becomes huge. If you have large pages, your page table becomes small, which is nice, I guess. And correspondingly, your TLB, think about the cache that needs to cache the page table entries. That becomes small also if you have large pages. Reach of the translation look-aside buffer. I guess we will see this right now, maybe. If you have large pages, your TLB can reach more of your physical virtual memory space. Right? Let's say your pages are of 1 gigabyte size, and you have 32 TLB entries. Your TLB now can cover, this is called the TLB reach, 32 times 1 gigabyte of your memory space. That's 32 gigabytes. Whereas if you have small pages, let's say 4 kilobytes, and your TLB is still 32 entries, because you need to access it fast, your TLB can cover only 32 times 4 kilobytes, which is really small if you think about it, right? Which means that if you have a large memory footprint, large memory working set, and if you have small pages, and your TLB reach is small, it's very likely that your TLB will not be able to do the translation. You'll get TLB misses. We'll get to TLB misses soon, but that's the idea. That's what you do at the page size level, at the ISA level, also affects the optimizations that happen at the microarchitecture level. You get a lot of TLB misses if you have small pages because your footprint may be much larger than what your TLB can cover. Is this clear? Because your TLB is really designed for fast access, right? So we'll get to this. If you remember, please ask me. Transfer size from disk to memory. Remember page? We said that a page in virtual memory is the same size as a page in physical memory, a frame in physical memory. And that's probably a good idea to do, but it doesn't have to be that way. But if you have a large page, now you need to transfer a lot more from disk to memory. Right? Same as a cache block. If you have a large cache block, you need to transfer a lot more from main memory to cache. And maybe you're wasting bandwidth. What if you're not using a lot of that page? Large page. Make sense? So if your spatial locality is not very good, again, large page may not be a great idea. Waste of space within a page. What if you only need, let's say you really have a small amount of memory to deal with, and you only need 1 kilobytes, but your page size is 1 gigabytes. Well, there's no flexibility. You just allocate a 1 gigabyte page, right? Even though you're going to use only 1 kilobyte of it. So you're really wasting space within a page. You may not be using it at all. It's not just referencing, right? This is different from referencing. It's stronger from referencing. You may not be referencing. You may not even be allocating that part because your data structure is only 1 kilobyte. You're dealing with such a data structure. If you have a large page, you have no choice. If you have a small page, your this is called internal fragmentation. You're really, your page is really fragmented. Your page size is much bigger than what you really need. So you can reduce that by reducing the size of the page. There's also waste of space within the entire physical memory, external fragmentation, which is different from internal fragmentation. If you have large pages, maybe you don't have a lot of external fragmentation, right? External fragmentation means how do you manage the space across the entire physical memory? Right? If you have holes, how do you find them? Right? And if you don't deal with that, you may fragment your external entire physical memory. Granularity of access protection. That's another thing that the page size determines. For example, if you want to protect pages, protect things at a very fine granularity, I don't know, maybe 8 bytes. You may imagine why you may need that protection. You don't get it with a large page, right? You really have this entire page and you protect it at that level. Think about it as an array. If you want to protect this array from some other array in memory, and the array is small, well, you cannot provide that protection granularity. You need to allocate these two different arrays at different places in memory. Okay. Dot, dot, dot. There are a lot of other things that the page size actually effects. So I'd like you to think about it a little bit, because there's a lot to cover over here. But I'm actually surprised that you didn't cover it in 213. Because this is one of the fundamental trade-offs in virtual memory. Right? What should be your page size? Because this is really etched into your ISA also. OK, so we will probably get back to this, because modern ISAs, if you look at them, they actually have multiple page sizes for this reason, because this is really important. And it really affects a lot of the decisions. As a result, one size really doesn't fit all. So x86, for example, has 4 kilobytes and 4 megabyte pages, and I believe a little bit more also. Does anybody know? What are the largest pages in x86? I believe you can have 2 gigabyte pages also. OK, maybe that's a good question to figure out. Maybe we should give extra credit for figuring that out. OK. This is actually, before we move on, this is another place where caches and pages, caches and virtual memory differ. It's difficult to support multiple granularities in a hardware cache, whereas it may be a little bit easier to support in the operating system. Because really, remember, you're managing this at the operating system level. Having multiple sizes is a lot easier, because it's all software-based management. Whereas if you had cache block sizes that are of 8 bytes, 64 bytes, and 4 kilobytes, how do you design the tag store in hardware to actually do that access? That becomes a little bit difficult. You can do it, but it becomes difficult. And your complexity of hardware increases. Okay. So let's talk about access protection and control. As I said, there are these protection bits, and I kind of tacked them on to the translation, right? Basically, virtual memory provides page-level access control or protection. Not every process is allowed to access every page. For example, at the system level, you may want to protect something such that only the supervisor level or the kernel level can have access to system pages. That makes sense, because you don't want any user program to destroy your random page tables, right? Or the process scheduler. You may not want your user program to touch these system-level functions. So the idea is to store access control information on a page basis in the process's page table. So it can actually use this translation, indirection mechanism, to do the protection also. And it can enforce this access control at the same time as translation, because whenever you're doing a load or store, you're really doing the translation. So you might as well do the protection or access control as well. So today's virtual memory systems actually serve two functions. I motivated the address translation for illusion of large physical memory and the other benefits that come with the translation, and also access control, protection. So this is kind of the cartoonish picture. Whenever you're doing this translation, you not only do the translation, but also check the protection bits, access control bits. And the PTE, page table entry, contains access control bits associated with the virtual page. And this is kind of a cartoonish, another cartoonish example. You're extending the page table entries with permission or access control bits. And you check these bits on each access and also during a page fault. And if you violate, if the permissions that you're requesting doesn't match the permissions that is stored for you in your process, in your page table entry, then you get an access protection exception. For example, if you're trying to write to a page that is read-only for your process, you get an access protection exception. If you're trying to execute a page that you're not supposed to execute, then you get an access protection exception. And this execute, this is actually added relatively recently. There's a no execute bit that's kind of added to the entries. That way you cannot execute code that you're not allowed to execute. Right? This was a problem in some systems before. Okay, another cartoonish picture here. Basically, it's kind of the access control logic at the high level. Right? The inputs are the type of access that you're trying to do. It could be read, write, maybe execute, right? And the privilege level of the running process, what kind of privileges, this determines what you can do to this particular thing. And the protection bits of the page that is to be accessed. You get this from the page table entry. And then the access control logic decides whether the access is allowed or not allowed, right? So the type of access can be read, write, execute, right? And you can actually order these, right? Execute is probably I guess it really depends. And you can have actually no access also, right? That's another potential type of access. Privilege level, this is specified by the ISA. In VAX, for example, you had kernel, executive, supervisor, user. We'll see the counterparts in x86 relatively quickly. But you can take you can imagine many, many privilege levels, right? Depending on what you want to support. You can just have supervisor and user. And protection bits, these specify what type of access can be made to this page at what privilege level. It's basically who can do what to this page, right? And if your protection bits tell you that you can do this type of access to this page, then your access is allowed. So this is, I'm not going to go through this in detail, but this is kind of the privilege levels in x86. Level 0 is the highest privilege level. That's the operating system kernel. Level 1 and level 2 are the second highest. Operating system services execute at this level. And applications are really user space. That's the level 3. And whenever you need to switch between privilege levels, it takes a long time in x86, unfortunately, today. You basically need to do a level switch, a protection ring switch, as they say it in x86. So this is one example of page-level protection in x86. This puts a concrete picture to basically kind of this. Ignore the page directory entry. We'll get to this. That's basically related to multi-level page tables. But if your privilege level is user and access type is read-only, you can actually do that access, right? Or you can actually have a supervisor access and read-write access. This is actually an old one that doesn't have the execute permissions. But you can basically see the page table entry can specify what kind of privilege levels you can have. You can be supervisor, and the page can be read-only for you, right? That's certainly possible. Any questions? I'm going through this relatively quickly because these are relatively simple concepts. But the TLB, in a TLB, for example, you need to actually do this access control check. Okay, let's go through some issues in virtual memory, and then we'll take a break in the middle. There are three major issues that I'm going to focus on. One is, how large is the page table, and how do we store it and access it? So you may have realized that it's pretty large. Second, how can we speed up translation and access control check instead of for every access to memory going to memory again to do this? Can we do this better? And the third one is, when do we do the translation in relation to cache access? It's going to get intimate with the caches. There are many other issues we will not cover in detail. For example, what happens on a context switch, right? What do you do to the TLBs? How can you handle multiple page sizes, and efficiently, maybe? And dot, dot, dot. There are a lot of other issues. But let's take a look at one issue. How large is the page table? And where do you store it? Do you store it in hardware? Do you store it in physical memory? Do you store it in virtual memory? And where is the page table base register that you need to access? And how can you store it efficiently without requiring physical memory that can store all page tables in the system? Right. So people have developed the idea of multi-level page tables for this. Instead of having a single large page table, have a multi-level page table, and require that only the first level page table to be in physical memory. And hopefully that first level page table is relatively small. So we'll take a look at it. But the remaining levels can be in virtual memory. So you need to do a translation to access the page table. It's kind of cute, right? Page table enables you to do translation, but to get to the page table, you need to do the translation. As long as you ensure that the base page table is in physical memory, that should work. Okay? So let's look at the issue again. This is the page table. If you look at this, let's say you have a 64-bit address space, virtual address space, and a 40-bit physical address space. The page table can be huge. Basically, you need to have 2 to the 52 entries per process to get basically a physical frame number. In this case, it's 28 bits. I don't know if this is correct. Well, yeah, it is correct, right? Because your page frame number is 28 bits because your page offset is 12 bits only because we said 4 kilobyte pages. We didn't say it, but it's implicit over here. And assume that your page table entry size is 4 bytes. a single page table is really huge, right? It's 2 to the 54 bytes in this case. And this is the 10 to 16 times 10 to the 15 bytes. And that's just for one process. And the process may not be even using the entire virtual memory space. Actually, you may not even need that page table, need that huge page table, right? Because the process may not have allocated enough pages, enough virtual memory. You may actually, but you have to provide that illusion. You have to have that page table in some place. Well, have it in virtual memory. Right. That's the idea. The solution is, this is an example over here, is the multi-level page table. This is an example from x86, but you can see that it's general enough. And x86, remember, calls it linear address space. It's really the virtual address space. And a linear address is really a virtual address. This is how you do the translation. Instead of having a single-level page table, you have multi-level page tables. The first level is called the page directory, let's say. The second level is the page table within a directory. So this is the page table or page directory base register. That's the base register for the first level. That needs to be physical, because you have to have something in physical. If everything is virtual, you can never do translation in the end, right? You have to have something in physical memory. So this is basically the starting address in physical memory for the first level page table, page directory. You take this, add to it the page directory number, which is hopefully a few bits or a small number of bits than the total number of pages you have coming from the virtual address space. And then you get the page directory entry. Make sense? And that page directory entry specifies the base address of the page table to access. Okay? And this can be in disk. Now you know where your page table is, because this is in physical memory, you can access this. If this page directory, if this page table pointed to by this page directory entry is not in physical memory, you go to disk, bring it to physical memory first, and then you do the translation. Right? How do you do the translation? Now you have a physical frame number over here. That's the page table base register, or page table page address for this page. And you add to it the second level page address, which is coming from here, some bits over here. Does that make sense? Yes? Yes.
Base pointer?
Yes, only the base pointer. That's the, you can think of this as the page table base register. x86 is called the CR3, and I don't remember what CR stood for actually. Control register 3, I think, yeah. But only that needs to be stored as part of the context. Yes?
So do you need the page directory for each process in memory?
That's right, yes. That's right. So you have a vested interest in making this small so that you don't waste a lot of memory. But if you think about it, even if this is 10 bits, this is 2 to the 10 entries, and let's say this is 4 bytes, it's not that big. It's actually 4 kilobytes, right? It's not that big. And you can run out of physical memory, actually, if you have lots of processes. But today, we have so much physical memory that you run into other limits in the operating system before you run out of physical memory, because you need to store the page directories. And we'll see actually more soon. You can actually extend this, right? You can actually have 3-level page tables. You can have page super directory coming from the top, and then page directory, and then page tables. Right? You can call them anything else. I call them actually. I don't like the name page directory. You can call it the first level page table, second level page table, third level page table. That's what you're doing essentially, right? And if a process didn't allocate, if a process only needs one page, only the page directory and the page table entry for that will be in physical memory. Right? That's it. This is a lot more flexible. So you're using the virtual memory to actually store the page tables. Okay? And this is actually the final result. Basically, you get this gives you the physical address offset, the physical frame number for this entire page, if you will, and then you add to it the offset that you get, and then you access the real physical memory. This is the physical memory access. So you have a 2-level page table here. Okay? Any questions? It's pretty simple, right? Okay. How do we access the page table? So we've already said that there's a page table base register. This is the physical one in x86. And there's also a page table limit register. If the virtual page number is out of the bounds, which means that it exceeds the page table limit register, then the process did not allocate the virtual page. That's how you can determine, actually, whether the process allocated or didn't allocate. This leads to an access control exception. Basically, you check whether the address you're accessing is within bounds from the base and the limit. Okay? And this kind of answers your question, right? The page table base register is part of a process context. Just like program counters, status registers, general purpose registers, you need to have this to be able to do translation. And whenever you do a context switch, you need to get the context or page table base register or physical page table base register for the new process that you're putting in. Okay. So a little bit more on x86 page table. So let's get a little bit more concrete here. This is the address translation in x86 for a 4 kilobyte page using a 32-bit address. Remember, x86 has evolved over time. Before, they didn't even have 32-bit addresses. It started with a 16-bit address. We'll take a look at the 32-bit address. So what you do is this is the directory, and it consists of 10 bits. The top 10 bits specify the offset into the page directory table, and you take the page directory base register, CR3, add to it the offset, of course multiplied by the size of a page directory entry, and get the page directory entry over here. This tells you where the page table is located, or the second level page table is located, the offset, right? It could be in physical memory, it could be in disk. Let's assume that in physical memory, so this is a physical address if it's in physical memory. Then you add to it the next offset, which is also 10 bits in this case, and you get the page table entry. Now you have the page table entry, you have the physical address or physical frame number, you add to it the offset to get the address in the 4 kilobyte physical page. Make sense? So you can see that the page is 4 kilobytes in this case. And I think, assuming that you have only 4 bytes in your page directory entries and page table entries, the page directory is 4 kilobytes, and page tables are 4 kilobytes also. It's kind of nice because now your page table is within the page. Doesn't have to be the case. Okay? Now let's make it, large pages. How do you support large pages in x86? So this will hopefully give you an example. So this PS is really the page size. Whenever you access the page directory entry, you also check the page size. And based on that, you do the next access. In this case, PS is 0. Once you do this access, you figure out PS. There's a bit saying, what is that? What is my page size? In this case, PS 0 means it's 4 kilobytes, so you do this translation that way. Well, if PS is 1, x86 in this mode, the page directory entry is really one level. That's interesting, right? Because a large page is really 4 megabytes. Okay, so your offset is, this is really physical and you directly access it. And this has to be now in physical memory. But it's small, right? Because your pages are large. So only 4 kilobytes, you can actually access 4 megabytes in this case. Okay, so hopefully that gives you an idea. I'm not going to go through this in detail, but this kind of shows you what is the format of the page table entry. Basically, this is the valid bit over here, and PS bit, that's bit 7, that basically tells you the page size, and there are a bunch of other bits that you don't need to know about, but read-write, for example, the permission bits are somewhere here. Address of the page table, it's a page directory entry. This is a page table entry, address of the 4 kilobyte page frame, that's here. So you can see that this is similar to what you've seen earlier. I believe A is the access bit. But don't quote me on it because I don't remember. Okay? Oh, let's see. Accessed, there you go. That's why I have this over here. Okay, so you can examine this. You don't need to know everything over here, obviously, but you can have different kinds of page table entries depending on the levels. that CR3 looks like this, by the way. CR3 is always physical. It basically gives you the address of the page directory and lots of stuff that is not necessarily used right now. Okay, I'm going to skip that also. There's also four-level paging in x86. If you want to have a larger virtual address space and still keep the part of the page table that needs to be in physical memory small, this is what you do. You basically add more levels. Right? And I don't know how they came up with this name, but PML4, whatever that is, that's really the, let's see, I guess this is the third level page entry. I don't know if this should be called four level, really. This is the first level, second level, third level, I guess fourth level, yeah, why not? This basically gives you the first level entry. And you do the same thing, basically. Okay? It's really, this is the first level, you add CR3 to these bits to get the fourth level entry, page table entry, fourth level page table entry, and you use that as an offset to add to this next pointer, use that as an offset to get the next one, use that as an offset to add it to the here, and finally you get to the final page table, which hopefully gives you the physical frame number after you bring it in. Okay, so this is how you support a huge virtual address space while keeping minimal amount of space for page tables in physical memory. And you can read this if you're interested. Okay, let's stop here for 3 minutes, and then we'll cover the next two issues in virtual memory. In the meantime, if you haven't had Turkish Delight, it's somewhere over here. Okay, unless Rachada has finished everything. Okay, so feel free to get started with the second issue. How fast is the address translation? So hopefully it's clear now that you don't want to do many, many memory accesses to do a single address translation. In fact, think about the four level page table. You can actually get 3 page faults at the lower levels, right? Hopefully you don't get a page fault at the first page table, which is the page directory. But you can actually get 3 page faults. And if your page table entry spans multiple pages, that could happen. You can actually have multiple page faults per access. Sounds bad. So you may actually need to do lots of memory accesses to do a single translation, to do one memory access. I believe in VAX there was a corner case where for one translation you need to do 22 memory accesses. So how do we make it fast? Basically the idea is simple, and you know this already. Use a hardware structure that caches the page table entries, such that you don't spend any time to do this translation. Well, any time meaning you don't do any other memory access to do one memory access. That's the idea. Translation look-aside buffer. Assuming you hit in this cache. So this is the same as, this is yet another cache as we've discussed. And we'll see the structure. Or you can imagine the structure, right? The same choices exist here. What do we cache? We cache the page table entries. It's really the page table entry that you cache. And how should it be organized? Well, again, that's a design choice, right? It could be a small, fully associated buffer. It could be a large direct map cache, right? Again, your constraints will be determined by when you want to do this translation, which is going to be our next question in virtual memory. When do you do this translation? Do you do it before you access the first level cache? Do you do it after you access the first level cache? Do you do it in parallel with the access of the first level cache? We'll see. But let's take a look at this TLB first. As I said, it's a cache, so you can imagine different organizations. But what if you miss in this cache? A hit basically is easy, right? You basically do the address translation, and yet now you have your physical address. You can do anything you want with it. You can access anything. Assume that right now your translation is done before the cache access. Then you can access every cache after you do the translation. Right? But if you miss on a TLB, you have a choice now. What TLB entry do you replace? And who handles this TLB miss? Is it the job of the hardware or the software? Which means that is the TLB visible to the software, or is it purely managed by the hardware? And what should be done on a page fault, which is a separate question? Who handles the page fault, hardware or the software? Well, page fault is handled by the software, right? It can be accelerated by the hardware, but at some point you need to modify the page table. You need to actually modify that mapping. And that mapping exists in memory, so you need to actually do it in the software. Although you can accelerate most of it with hardware also. Okay. So let's take a look at this first choice. Well, I guess let me give you one example of a TLB first. It's basically a cache of recent address translation, and you don't go to the page table on every reference. And this is one example over here, right? Actually, this is a direct map cache in this case. The data that you have is really a page table entry. The tag is basically you index this with the virtual page number, and your tag is part of your virtual page number. You don't use the other part of the address, right? In this case, really, you're caching translations for a virtual page number. So your address that you're using to access the translation look-aside buffer is really your virtual page number. And your goal is to get a physical frame number for that virtual page number. It's really a mapping table, except it caches the page table entries. So you can imagine what your tag is, you can imagine what your data is, and you need, again, valid and dirty bits, perhaps, right? You definitely need a valid bit because it's a cache. And you may want a dirty bit, because that essentially is whether you've actually written to that particular page. Now this also should probably have you asking questions, right? We have this thing that's cached in hardware, and what if we do a store? Whenever you do a store to a page, do you actually go and update the page table entry in software, in memory? Well, maybe not, right? Because again, on every store, whenever you're doing a store, you may not want to go all the way to the real page table entry. Maybe you do the updates in this page table entry over here. And when this page table entry that's in the TLB gets evicted, then you update the real page table. It's just like a cache. Okay? So this dirty bit is actually different from the bit in the page table entry. This dirty bit specifies whether this page table entry you're cached is modified now. Okay? So think about it. It's kind of interesting. Like, virtual memory is really interesting because it gives you these different things, right? You're really doing translation inside translation with a multi-level page table. Okay, so handling TLB misses. The TLB is small, and it needs to be small because you actually want to do this translation quickly. So it cannot hold all the page table entries, so some translation requests will inevitably miss in the TLB. So you must access memory to find the appropriate page table entry to bring into the TLB. This is called the walking of the page directory or page table. Basically, what we were doing before was really walking the page directory or page table. So this walk requires a large performance penalty. So when you hear page walk, it's really going through and doing this translation after a TLB miss. So who handles the TLB misses? Is it the hardware or the software? Who does this page walk that we've done, right? You go through each page table and find the page table entry. So there are two approaches, obviously, hardware managed and software managed. When you get a TLB miss, the hardware does the page walk. x86, for example, is an example. In fact, the hardware unit is called a page walker in x86. And the hardware fetches the page table entry and inserts it into the TLB. So it does that multi-level page walk. If the TLB is full, the entry replaces another entry, and you can imagine any other replacement algorithm that we've discussed earlier. So this is all done transparently to system software, right? Except when you need to update the page table entry, right? So if you're evicting a dirty TLB entry, you need to update the page table entry that that is cached. So you actually need to go and do that. You can do that again in hardware, but it's not transparent to system software because you're modifying a system software data structure, right? Which is a page table. Okay. On the other hand, you can actually do all of this software managed. Whenever you get a TLB miss, well, what you do, you generate an exception and call in the operating system to do this page walk. And the operating system fetches the page table entry and it inserts and evicts entries in the TLB. So TLB is now managed by the system software. Right. Now you can imagine different algorithms that the system software may use, because it has a lot more information, hopefully, about all of the pages in the system. Whereas the hardware has information about just the TLB entries that it looks at. It caches. Okay, hardware managed TLB. The pros, there's no exception on a TLB miss. Instruction just stalls. Instruction that misses in the TLB just stalls. And it can actually execute, keep executing independent instructions. And if you have a large enough window size in an out of order machine, maybe you can hide the TLB miss latency, right? Well, why? Again, remember that this is all virtual memory. So page table entries are actually part of your physical memory, and they can be cached in your caches. It's really part of your physical address space. So let's say you got a TLB miss, and you try to figure out your page table entry, and you hit in the cache. That means that you kind of recently used that page table entry, except it didn't fit into your TLB. So you don't have it in your TLB, but it's in your cache. Because it's not only a translation, but it's like any other kind of data. So you can actually fetch that entry from a cache block in your cache and put it into TLB. So your cache miss, your TLB miss may not need to be long. If your page table entry is already in your lower level caches, or L2 cache or L3 cache, it can take much shorter. If your page table entry is in none of your caches, then it'll take long. You need to go to memory. Right? And you don't figure out whether there's a page fault or not until... Well, you can get page faults in any location, but until you get the page table entry, you don't figure out whether there's a page fault. Okay, so basically, if the TLB misses can be of varying latency. Some of the latency you can tolerate if your window size is large enough. Right? So independent instructions may continue. So having a hardware-managed TLB enables you to not stall, potentially, at all. And also, you don't bring any extra instructions or data into the caches, right? What does this mean? Basically, if you actually manage it in software, you need to bring in the exception handler. And that needs to execute, which means that you need to flush the pipeline such that you can actually execute the exception handler. Well, unless you have multiple threads and you can actually execute the exception handler in a fine-grained multi-thread context, right? But still, you need to bring some data. The downside here, if you have a hardware-managed TLB, the page directory or table organization is etched into the system. The operating system has little flexibility in deciding these, right? Because the hardware needs to manage it. Right? The opposite is software-managed TLB. The pro is now OS can define the page table organization. Maybe you don't need to etch it into the ISA, although maybe it's still a good idea, because the programmer needs to expect some things. This can enable more sophisticated TLB replacement policies also. Right? As I said, the operating system has the larger view of all pages in memory, so it can decide, oh, maybe I should bring in this page. Maybe I should also bring in these other, this page table entries. Maybe I should evict this page table entry because I'm not going to reuse it. Or maybe I should also prefetch some of these other page table entries that I think are going to be reused. Right? You can actually do prefetching in the TLB. The con is, the big downside is, you need to generate an exception. Right? As a result, you have a performance overhead due to a potential pipeline flush. You need to execute the exception handler. So these are instructions that need to go through the pipeline because it's the software handling it. And extra instructions and data that are brought to the caches. So with the techniques that we've discussed, you can hide some of these latencies, right? For example, the pipeline flush latency. You don't need to flush the pipeline, maybe. If you have multiple contexts, this context actually got a TLB miss, well, you get it out of the pipeline. And then bring in the exception handler, right? And then you switch. If you have fine-grained multi-threading, that actually helps a lot of these context switch issues. It helps with exception handling also. Okay, so in the remaining time, I'll talk about issue 3. And we're going to get even more intimate with caches. So when do we do the address translation? This is something that we didn't discuss so far. Do we do it before or after accessing the L1 cache? Because this actually creates problems in caches. And that's the virtual memory and cache interaction. In other words, is the cache virtually addressed or physically addressed? Have you guys seen this in 2.13? Really? No, it'll be fun then. So a virtually addressed cache is also called a virtual cache. And a physically addressed cache is a physical cache. But there are some issues with a virtually addressed cache. Can you guys imagine what it is? Well, one thing that will cause issues is a synonym problem. Basically, you can have two different virtual addresses that can map to the same physical address, right? Which means that same physical address can be present in multiple locations in the cache if you're actually using the virtual address to index into the cache, right? If you're using the physical address to index into the cache, that's not a problem. Because the same physical address, there's only one physical address, right? But if you're using the virtual address now, you may have multiple copies of the same physical address anywhere in the cache, actually. So if one process, can this happen? Because one process is sharing data with another process, and it's using different virtual addresses. It just happened to be that way, to refer to the same physical address. If process one updates that data, it's updating one location in the cache, and the other location that stores the same physical address is now out of date. So you have a consistency problem, right? It can lead to inconsistency in data. It's also called a coherence problem. But now you're having the coherence problem within your cache, the same cache. So that's why a virtual cache is actually very difficult to manage. So let me introduce homonyms and synonyms also, because these are kind of related and often confused. Homonym is kind of the opposite or dual of the synonym. Basically, in a homonym, the same virtual address can map to two different physical addresses. Right? And this happens a lot, right? Because you have different processes, obviously, right? You have virtual address and different processes. Virtual address 0 maps to physical address 5,000 here. Virtual address 0 in the other process maps to physical address a billion, right? Yeah. It's easier to handle homonyms, actually. And they cause less of a problem because you can actually separate, you can actually say, oh, these, you can actually have address space IDs, for example, right? Thread IDs, let's say. So I'm not going to discuss this in detail, but you can think of issues related to this. Synonyms are harder because now you have different virtual addresses mapping to the same physical address. And why can this happen? Because different pages can share the same physical frame within or across processes. And we've already discussed actually many of these, right? Actually, I think we've discussed all of these. Shared libraries, shared data, copy on write pages within the same process or across processes. Okay. So whether homonyms and synonyms create problems when we have a cache really depends on the answer to this question. Is the cache virtually or physically addressed? And there are three choices that you have, actually. You can have a physical cache. You do the translation before the cache access. And only when you get the physical address, you access the cache. Then there's no problem, right? The upside, there's no problem with homonyms and synonyms. Well, let's just consider synonyms right now. There's no problem with synonyms because a physical address can be in only one place in the cache. You never have a consistency problem. The downside, well, now you're serializing accesses, right? Even if this takes one cycle, you're delaying every load and store with one cycle. It may not take one cycle. It may take a few cycles to access your TLB if you're clocking your processor high. The other option, do this. Basically, do the cache access and then do the translation because you want to get the data quickly, right, and supply it. In this case, this is virtual, right? This is the virtual address, physical address boundary. This is when you actually have the physical address. Now you run into the synonym problem. Here, a physical address can be in any location in the cache, right? Because you disregard the physical address. You're just virtually indexing it. And virtual to a physical mapping is really very flexible, right? You can map a virtual page to any physical frame. And if you have 1,000 processes, different virtual pages can be mapped to the same physical page, and that address can be in many places in the cache. So it's very hard to control this. This other option, but the upside over here is obviously your cache access, your access control and translation is not on the critical path. So how do we get the best of both worlds? And that's the idea of this. This is the virtual physical cache. Basically, you do the cache access, you start the cache access, And at the same time, you start the TLB access because you have the address at the same time. And you get the physical address from the TLB, and you check whether the physical address and the cache matches. Well, how do you do that? Well, maybe the tag should be physical, but you can start the cache access with the virtual address. Does that make sense? Basically, you can virtually index your cache and then do the translation in parallel and check whether the address that you've stored actually matches the real physical address that you're looking for. That's the idea of a virtually indexed, physically tagged cache. And the upside of this is now the TLB access is hopefully not on the critical path, although there's a check you need to do over here. But it's not as bad as this. The downside is your synonym sign can still cause problems. Yes?
Well, what is the problem where instead of synonym, there's a synonym problem where we change processes and now the virtual address that corresponds to a physical address in cache is different from across processes.
That's right, yes.
So if it does like get a hit, but it gets the wrong physical address.
That's right, yes.
And then it detects it down there.
Yeah.
How do you like link it back up?
So it detects it down here, right?
Yeah, and then what?
Then you basically get a fault. You're not supposed to access it.
But that's software.
Yeah, that's right. So you handle it somehow. So it's easier to handle that one, homonym one. So there are multiple solutions. I'm not going to discuss it in detail, but one thing is you can actually have IDs, address-based IDs, saying that this virtual address belongs to this process. Right? You can actually fix that problem that way. Or whenever you are done with a process, you can flush your cache. Another possibility, which you may or may not want to do. But the other option is because you already have the physical address over here, you're safe, right? Okay, so let's take a look at these options a little bit. This is the physically indexed, physically tagged cache. Basically, what it looks like is you do the TLB access, and you get the physical address. Basically, this is your physical address. And you use the physical address to form your cache address. Your index is physical. Your tag is physical. So a physical address can be in only one location, right, in the cache. So there's no problem here. This is the virtually indexed, virtually tagged cache. Basically, this is your virtual address. There's nothing physical here. Your index is virtual. Your tag is virtual. Well, you have a lot of problems here, right? Because if different virtual addresses map to the same physical address, they can be in any location. They can be in any index, right? The same physical address can be in any index in the cache. And if one of them updates the cache using the virtual address, you will need to ensure that the consistency problem doesn't happen, right? Is this clear? Yes? Okay. You may need to think about it a little bit. So virtual physical cache looks like this, or virtually indexed physically tagged. This is your virtual address. You take the virtual page number, give it to the TLB, and TLB you start the TLB access. At the same time, you interpret the virtual address as a cache address, and you index the cache with it. And hopefully at some point, you get the physical frame number from the TLB corresponding to this virtual page number. And you completed the cache access, and you compare the tag to the physical frame number. If the tag matches the physical frame number, that's great. Your physical address is in the cache. If the tag doesn't match, then you have a cache miss, right? Or maybe the thing that you're looking for is not the right, is not this physical address, right? So here there's still a question, right? Where can the same physical address be in the cache? So if you have where can the same physical address be? This should be fixed. Can the same physical address be in multiple locations in the cache in this case? Yes or no? Yes, you're saying. Why? You still have the synonym problem, yes. Because the two virtual addresses can map to the same physical address. And here, you actually are indexing with part of your virtual address. So two virtual addresses that map to the same physical address may have two different indices. and that physical address may be in those two different locations. Okay, let's take a look. Remember the talk that was given by Dick Seitz? There was this equation, page size times associativity. Here's a mystery result, I guess, if you will, or it will be resolved. If your cache size is less than the page size times associativity, the cache index bits come only from the page offset. So the problem is really happening is because the problem is happening because you're indexing the cache with things, with bits that change during translation. In the last few moments, let's do this. Let's see if this can respond quickly. Apparently not. Please wait. Oh, okay, it did respond quickly. Okay, let's do this. Basically, what we're doing is we have this virtual address, and we have this page offset in the virtual address. And this is our tag store. We're interpreting this virtual address, and we're taking a virtual index. Let's say our index bits come from here, right? We're taking, I don't know, 2 bits. Why not? 1 bit from here, and 1 bit from the page offset, right? Now, let's also take an example. This also goes to TLB, right? Now, I'll call this part of the address A. And you have a page, virtual page A0, and you have another virtual page A1. Let's say they map to the same physical page. Physical frame, I don't know, number 0. But they have different indices, right? One of them has an index 0, I don't know, let's say that page offset is the same, 0, 0. And the other one has an index 1, 0, right? So the same physical address, A0, A1, let's assume everything else is 0 over here, mapped to two different locations in the cache. Why? Because we're taking the index bits from here that change during translation, and two virtual addresses that may differ in these index bits can map to the same physical address or physical frame number. As a result, you may have the same physical address in two different locations. In fact, the number of locations where you may have the same physical address in the cache is dependent on how many bits you're taking from here. If you're taking n bits, the same physical address can be in two of the n different locations in the cache. So if one process updates A0, it really updates this location, and you need to maintain coherence of this location. That's the problem with the virtually indexed physically tagged cache. Now, this problem doesn't exist if you're taking no bits from the virtual page number, from the part of the virtual address that doesn't change during translation. Right? Basically, you can interpret a virtual address in two ways, right? One is the page offset. This is the first interpretation, page offset, virtual page number. And you can interpret it as a cache address. If your index comes from here, the bits from the page offset. Now, these things don't change during, you're not really indexing into locations with a virtual page number that actually changes during translation, that gives you something. But you're storing physical frame numbers here, right? So your index is really not virtual at that point, right? It's really physical. Because page offset doesn't change during translation. It doesn't matter if it's virtual or physical, in other words. So you can start the cache access with what you know. And after translation, you check the page frame number. There's no problem here because a physical address now can be in only one location, which is indicated by the index, because this is really physical. So you can still have a virtually indexed, physically tagged cache without having the synonym problem, without having synonyms causing problems for you. The problem here is now your cache size needs to be limited to what is specified by here, right? The number of sets you have is 2 to the number of index bits, and that's it. And times the associativity, and if you think about this, this is really the byte in block. This is really how many bytes you have. So it's really, you tutor the number of index bits times the block size times the associativity. Right. Well, what is tutor the number of index bits times the block size? It's really the page size. Right? Because you're limiting your index to whatever you can get from the page offset. So your tutor the index bits, the number of sets in your cache, is limited to here. And now you can trade off the block size with the number of sets you have, because you want to be limited here. As a result, your cache size needs to be limited to page size times associativity in order to make sure that your index is really coming from the page offset, which means that your index is really physical, right? Does that make sense? So if you do this, if your cache size is less than or equal to page size times associativity, the cache index bits come only from the page offset. They're the same in virtual address and physical address. Now you have no problems with the synonyms, because the physical address can be in only one location in the cache. And you do the, you start the TLB access right away. You get the physical frame number. And you start the cache access right away when you get the virtual address. You get the tag, which is the physical frame number. If the tag matches the physical frame number, you get a cache hit. And that's the only location. But if that's not the case, if you want to make your cache size even bigger, you run into the synonym issues. Basically, your index, some of your index bits come here. Now the same physical address can exist in two locations, assuming A is 1, if you're using one index. So hopefully that was clear. So if you, as the number of index bits increases, the number of locations where two physical address, the same physical address can exist increases. In fact, exponentially. It's really 2 to the A, right, in this case. Then the question is, how do you solve it? Basically, we don't want to limit the size of our cache to page size times associativity, which Dick Seitel was complaining about. There's no reason to limit it. In fact, many processors, including some of the processors he designed, didn't limit it. Alpha. But maybe Intel processors decide to limit it. How do you actually solve the synonym problem? Well, there are several solutions. Well, one is to kind of limit your cache size to page size times associativity. You get the index from the page offset. The second solution is provide a simple form of coherence. When you write to, let's say, you write to a physical, assume that your bits can come from the virtual page number to index into your cache. When you write to a location, you check all of the other possible locations in the cache where this physical address might exist. And you have only a limited number of locations. If you're taking only one bit here, A0, remember A is the remaining bits here. A0 is one location that you're updating. Well, check A1. If you have the same physical address, write there too, or invalidate it. Right. Well, if you're taking two bits, let's say you're updating A00, check A01, A10, A11. Check if you actually cache the same physical address in any of these indices. Yes? Now you have a choice. If you have cached it, then you have a choice. You update all of those locations with the same thing that you're writing, or you invalidate. Okay? So this is used in Alpha 21.264, MIPS R10,000. So actually, people have designed caches that does this, that do this. The other option is to restrict the page placement in the operating system. I guess we're running out of time, so I'll be done quickly. I think there's a faculty candidate talk over here. The other option is restrict the page placements in the operating system. The operating system says, oh, I'm going to make sure that the index of the virtual address is the same as the index of the physical address. Basically, these things, at the operating system level, you're going to ensure that these bits never change during translation. Now, this clearly restricts which pages, which virtual pages can be mapped to which physical frames. And this is also called page coloring. Think of the physical frame memory divided into colors. You can only allocate the same colors from the virtual space to the physical space. This is used in many Spark processors, in fact. Okay? So this is actually a pretty fascinating topic. We'll go back to page coloring. But I'll finish with this. There's problem 5. I believe it's the same problem 5. And this is a really nice problem from the midterm exam. And it may happen in your midterm exam, too. Okay. So enjoy spring break. But don't get behind on your labs. And if you want to have more Turkish delight, there's more. If Rachada hasn't finished, I'm okay.